Doing today? Everybody that made it here today should be great. So today, we're going to do something a little bit different. And that'll be later on, so don't worry about that. But our first three songs, I was kind of getting things together and wanted to conjoin songs that A, work well together musically, and B, tell a bit of a story or at least have a sense of direction. So these three songs that I picked for the first set is more of a realization of the first song is who God is, what he is, or what he is capable of. Waymaker, it's talking about him being here, being with us. He's in our midst. He's in this place. He's the one who touches your heart. He heals your heart. He mends, and he turns lives around. That is a realization that we have in the first song. The second song is a realization of what we are. We are ruins. We are nothing without God, without Jesus. We're nothing. And it talks about how the mountains fall and the tempests roar, and God is still with us, even though we're ruins. He is with us through it all. When the creation folds, my soul will still soar on his mercy. Isn't it great that God gave mercy for us? Amen. We can walk through the fire with our head lifted high. How many times in your life can you say that without God? That'd be none. And then the third song is a realization of how beautiful his plan has been for us. So it talks about the word at the beginning. That's where it all starts, getting into the word, knowing God, and the Holy Spirit come into our lives. And now, his name. His name is what we have. It is beautiful. It is wonderful. It is powerful. There is no rival. There is no equal, now and forever. God will reign. Whether I like it, whether you like it, God will reign. It is up to us if we want to be there with him. That was always his plan. That is the realization that we come to through these three songs is he wants us to be with him. So, as we stand and sing today, let's start singing Waymaker.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. Thank you. Thank you.
seated.
Good morning and welcome to Woodland Bible Church. As you may be wondering, you don't see Pastor Wayne or Pastor Steve here, and both of them are slightly out of commission. Pastor Wayne and Michelle are doing much better, and they should be back joining us, I would think, next week. Pastor Steve has a terrible cough, and he loses his voice. So I get to be your person for announcements this morning. So first of all, I want to just announce for the LIFT group is meeting tonight, 6 o'clock, at Stephen Darla's house, and all high school students are asked to join them. And then tonight also, junior high youth group is meeting here at the church in the fellowship hall, and that's for 6th, 7th, and 8th grade students. Come and enjoy food, crazy game, a current event, and lots of fun discussion. Awana meets Wednesday night at 6 o'clock to 7 o'clock or 7:30. Kids K through 8th will meet at the high school commons, and then I believe, is Cubby's still meeting here? Yes? Yes. Okay. FCA Wednesday night, 7 to 8:30 for the 9th through 12th graders, and they will be meeting at Stephen Darler's house for food, games, and devotion time. And then finally, I'd like to mention that on next Saturday at 7 p.m. here at the church, we will have the annual business meeting. So come and get involved in the church business, and we look forward to seeing you all there. Let's go ahead and start our service in prayer, or continue our service in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for your mercy and your love. Thank you that you never forsake us. You're always here for us. We thank you for this church, and you brought us all here together to be able to worship you, to glorify your name, to be taught, and to continue to grow in our faith. And I pray, Father, this morning that you would be encouraging the congregation to help them to grow in your love. I also pray for those who are wrestling with health issues. There's a lot of people missing this morning, and we know that there's a lot of illness going around. We pray for safety. We pray for quick healing, and we pray also, Father, that you would encourage those who aren't able to be here this morning. So, Lord, we just thank you again for your love, and we commit this morning to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Adam?
We get to worship Jesus. We get to do that. We might not get to next week. And that's the reality of it. So I'm going to challenge everybody this morning. I want you to worship these next two songs like it's our last time together. Probably won't be our last time together. We probably will be here next week, and we will be worshiping. But every time that I come to worship Jesus Christ, I do it as if it's my last. So today, I'm going to ask all of you to stand. And I know this is a challenge for men. Go to the place where you feel closest to God. I know it is hard for some of us to go to that place, to feel close to Him when we're standing together, side by side with Christians, shoulder to shoulder. So I want you to imagine yourself in that place. God gives you a place to go. Where does He give you? So as we sing these next two songs, cry out to God. Raise your hallelujah. Bless all of you.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a I'm
Jason, would you hit the lights, please? During this last song, I want everybody to sit down. In that place that I was talking about earlier, I want you to go there. Man, woman, child, whoever's left, if you have to close your eyes, go there. If you have to raise your hands to the sky, go there. If you have to fold your hands, go there. If you need to get down on your knees, go there. Psalm 23:4. Even though I walk through the valley of death, I fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and staff, they comfort me. Where you go, he is. He is there to comfort you. Now there's three verses that come before that. And that is where I want us to take our place that God gives us. That is the scripture that I want us to cling to, that will give us a realization of where we need to go when we need to be with God. Anna, can you read that for us?
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his namesake.
Please sing with us.
Lord, I go.
Is he not? Amen. Please stay seated.
Let's pray. Father, I just thank you for the privilege to be called your child and to have an opportunity to come and share your word with this body of believers. God, I pray that you would open our hearts to receive the message that you have. I pray, Father, that you would open our ears to hear and our hearts to receive the things that will benefit us and help us to grow in our walk with you. I just lay this all before you, Jesus. I thank you for your love again. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so most of you know that I have done a little bit of teaching in the past. And there are three things that you will notice right away. The first one is I have a hard time standing still. I always move around when I talk. Anna was teasing me beforehand. She said, Dad, how many times are you going to pace back and forth on the stage? And I said, I don't know. Count them. The second thing is I like to ask questions. And the third thing is I have to have my coffee. So if I pick up my coffee and I sip it, it's just nervous habit. Bear with me. Show me a little grace as I get into God's word this morning. As I mentioned earlier, Steve and Darla, Darla is here. Steve is still wrestling with his cough. Wayne and Michelle are recovering nicely, and they should be back with us shortly. But they did ask me to come and preach the message this morning, and so I'm honored to be able to be here to share God's word with you. And so I'm going to start off with a series of questions, and I want to see a show of hands, okay? Can everybody who's here this morning raise their hand, please? All right, I just wanted to see if there's a... I saw you back there. No, just kidding. All right, I'm going to ask you some questions, and I want you to respond by raising your hand. It doesn't matter left hand or right hand. I just like you to raise your hand. So here's the question I have. How many of you have ever encountered a trial or a difficulty? Raise your hand. Okay. How many of you who raise your hand have had car problems? Raise your hand. I can feel your pain. Frozen pipes. Raise your hand. Okay. The pleasure of living in War Road. A misunderstanding with a friend. Raise your hand. Okay. Got your fingers so cold that you didn't want them to warm up because it would hurt so bad. Definitely a War Road thing. How many of you have ever had challenges at work? A disagreement with your spouse, with a friend, with yourself? How many of you have ever lost a loved one? Hit your finger with a hammer. Isn't that painful? Adam, I saw you raise your hand. Got a scrap or got soap in your eye? How about this one? Guys, pay attention. Didn't read the instructions and messed up royally assembling something you had just bought. I saw wives going. Spilled something on your favorite blouse or shirt that happened to be light colored. Yep. Last one. How many of you have cheered for the Vikings? Okay. My high school friend and I had just finished bowling, and we did all right. It wasn't anything to brag about, but it was okay. And we were driving into the cul-de-sac at our house, our townhouse down in Minneapolis. And so as we pulled around the corner there, I noticed that there were a bunch of emergency vehicles with their lights flashing. And that sick, sinking feeling hit me. And as we pulled in next door to our townhouse where all the emergency vehicles were at, I hopped out of the car and I ran to the front door and I opened up the door and there were the paramedics doing CPR on my dad on the living room floor. My mom was standing there in tears. She said to me, "Danny, I think we've lost him." The paramedic turned to me and he said, "Go guide the ambulance in. They're having trouble finding your place." And so I jumped in the car, sped to the north entrance, and sat there waiting, looking for the ambulance to show up. Minutes went by. And with every minute, my heart sank and my anxiety raised. And then, after what seemed like forever, I now noticed out of the corner of my eye the ambulance heading out of the subdivision at the south entrance. "Count it all joy, my brethren, when you meet various trials, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing." This verse seems totally out of context. Really? Count it joy? Perfect? Complete? And what in the world is steadfastness anyways? Earlier in that year, 1979, I had transferred to Bemidji State University. My life was, well, it felt like it was in shambles, but it was just God's way of grabbing a hold of me and getting a hold of my life. And through a series of events, I put my faith and trust in Jesus Christ. He was my Lord and Savior. And during that time period, James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4, jumped out to me. And God showed me that there is purpose in trials. Back in the hospital, we sat in the waiting room trying to learn if my dad was going to live or die, or even maybe worse yet, become a vegetable. These words kept on cycling through my mind, and I had a strange sense of peace. Where did that come from? As testified by my little survey this morning, all of us had gone through trials. And if you haven't, just hang around for a little while, and one's going to find you really soon. My mom used to say they come in threes. I think they come more than that. I think they come in waves of 100 or 150. It's part of life. And not just for the Christian, but for everyone. Whether or not you believe that there is a God in heaven and he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die for your sins and raise again or not. But the fact that remains, everyone has trials, doesn't necessarily justify the words of this verse. You look at this and you go, it doesn't necessarily make sense to me. This verse seems counterintuitive. It just doesn't hold water. But to fully understand it, we need to take a step back and look at the big picture. The psalmist put it succinctly, "When I tried to understand all this, it troubled me deeply, till I entered the sanctuary of God, and then I understood their final destiny." Let's start by considering God's story. God created a perfect world when Adam and Eve sinned, causing the world to be subjected to futility. Romans 8:20 puts it this way, "For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope." God determined to redeem man by sending his son to die on the cross, to pay the sin debt and to reconcile man to God. But I want you to catch this. But the consequences of sin still impact the world. And not until he returns will that be changed. Let me say that one more time. The consequences of sin still impact the world. And not until he returns will that be changed. If we take the rest of Romans chapter 8, verses 18 and 19, and then on to 21, it says, I consider that our present suffering are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. And it goes on that the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God. There are three things that I want us to realize out of this. Three things that you'll find in the handout that you can write down. The first one is this: God's story has a beginning and an end. God's story has a beginning and an end. The beginning contains the fall. The end is eternity with him. What happens in the middle is affected by the beginning. But the events in the middle contribute to the end result. This is an underlying truth needed to be able to put sense to James chapter 1, verse 2 through 4. Romans 8:18 talks about the present suffering are not worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed. In who? It said, in us. That glory is going to be revealed in us. It's because he wants to bring us to himself with freedom and glory. He cares about us. He wants us to be revealed. Not just our identity, who are you, but our character. He wants our character to be revealed. Developing character takes trials, and it takes time. Paul adds in Romans 5, verses 3 through 5, not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Even though the world we live in today is temporary, God's perspective is eternal. His end game gives us hope because if we just focus on the world, it is meaningless. It's still subjected to futility, suffering, and trials. Hope is things yet not received. Hebrews puts it this way. Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance what we do not see. It goes on in chapter 6, verse 19. We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. So let's review. The first point is God's story has a beginning and an end. The second point is God is in control. God is in control. Nothing in this world is out of his control. But guess what? It is all out of our control. Nothing is out of God's control, but it is all out of our control. If it were in our control, would we choose trials to build our character and confidence and hope? I don't think so. Verse 20 describes that the creation was subjected. Subjected by who? For the creation was subjected in frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it in hope. Do you get it? He's in control. He's the one who subjected the world to this futility. Why? Because he had hope for the future. He knew what was going to happen in the future. He is in control. But that might beg the question, can we trust him? Can we trust him? He's in control, but can we trust him? Proverbs 3:5 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. It's a famous verse. We all have heard it before, but it is ultimately true. that we should be trusting in God. God is trustworthy. Who else would we trust? Ourselves? As my favorite movie character would say, not hardly. It just does not happen that way. Number three, He has a plan. There is purpose in the things we experience. It's how we respond to these that determine our joy. Not only is man affected by God's plan, but all of creation is as well. But is His plan good? Is He trustworthy? Jeremiah 29, verse 11 says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." If you know anything about the story of Jeremiah, he spoke those words to the people who had been taken into captivity because of their sin. He's got a plan. He allows these things to happen for a reason. So let's review. We are told in James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4, that we should consider it all joy when we're encountering trials. To be able to understand this, we need to understand God's story. How that the world is subjected to futility because of sin, and the broken world is therefore full of trials. God's story has a beginning and an end. We are living in the middle of that. God is in control. We are not. And God has a plan, and He is trustworthy. So how do these facts help us understand trials? How do we make sense of this in our lives? We have a foundation laid. Let's dispel some false assumptions, and at the same time, dig into what God wants to produce in the trials and see how we can engage with that for God's purpose. False assumption number one. You've probably heard these. You've probably thought of these. I have accepted Christ. I won't have any troubles. False assumption number one. Everyone will encounter trials. Since sin is the root cause of trials and the entire world is infected, it is incorrect to expect Christians to be exempt. 1 Peter 1:6 says, "In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief of all kinds of trials." Christians are more likely to have more trials because of our faith. So not only it's assumed that we're going to have trials in this world, but we probably have more because in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, it says, "In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." What He does promise, however, is that He will rescue the godly from trials. 2 Peter 2:9 says, "If this is so, then the Lord knows how to rescue the godly from trials and to hold the unrighteous for punishment in the day of trouble, in the day of judgment." So He knows what's going on, and He also promises rescue from it. Scripture is very clear. We will encounter trials. Sorry, but that's just the way it is. The key to understanding is seeing that the purpose of the trials. Trials have a purpose. They are not random acts of displeasure, regardless of how small or how big. False assumption number two. God wants me to be happy even when things are going south. No, sorry. That is not what James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4 say. As you know, there is a significant difference between joy and happiness. God does not expect us to artificially pretend that our trials are no big deal and that we should have a smile plastered on our face all the time. It isn't what He expects at all. No matter what happens, no. He wants us to be real, not artificial, but He wants us to consider it joy, pure joy. So let's look at some key words and phrases in James chapter 1, 2 through 4. First, let's look at the words steadfastness. Steadfastness is defined as the quality of being resolutely or dutifully firm and unwavering. When I became a Christian, I used the RSV, Revised Standard Version of the Bible. I think that's the only one that translates this word, hopomone, as steadfastness. It's a Greek word. Other translations use perseverance, patience, endurance. In Strong Concordance, it also attributes the idea of cheerful or hopeful constancy. Hopeful constancy. If you take that and apply it, that God wants to produce or develop our perseverance, it also is helpful to understand what that really looks like. Turning to Galatians 5, 22 and 23, the qualities that God wants us to persistently and hopefully pursue are the fruit of the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Patiently pursuing in the midst of trials produces these character qualities. Let me say that again. Patiently persevering in the midst of trials produces these character qualities. It's the end game we are talking about earlier. God allows trials to be in our lives to produce fruit in keeping with his long-term plan for our spiritual growth. Let me say that again as well. God allows trials to be in our lives to produce fruit in keeping with his long-term plan for our spiritual growth. If you don't get anything else out of the message today, I want you to get that one. The next time you encounter a trial, ask yourself, what is God trying to teach me out of this? Most of you already know this. This is not anything new, but it is good to be reminded. Plus, you might be tempted, and this caused you some doubt about this truth. As most of you know, my bride suffers from migraine headaches, and this is a constant trial to her and me. Oftentimes we plan something and we are met with a headache and with disappointment. I tell you this not looking for sympathy, but to explain that sometimes I lose sight of God's purpose. And in those times I start to get angry and frustrated, even to the point of railing at God. I've been a follower of Jesus for more than 40 years, and yet I still stumble and I struggle with it daily. When I do that, I am not considering the pure joy of eternity and the character he is developing in me. Instead, I am thinking of how unfair, how unpleasant, how painful, how discouraging it is. And then I start to ask questions why. Why does a loving God allow things like this to happen? And if he's so all-powerful and in control, but won't do anything about it, what's the good of following him anyways then? The next two false assumptions are kind of tied to this thought pattern. False assumption number three. Trials come because I have been disobedient. God is punishing me. How can I have joy if God is punishing me? I don't even know what he's punishing me for. Trials came because of sin. Not necessarily as a punishment for sins we have committed, but because the world is subjected to the effects of sin. Throughout the Old Testament, we see how God is trying to bring his people back. I'm reading the book of Jeremiah right now. The theme is, stop worshiping idols, return to me, or I will punish you. We all know what happened to the children of Israel. They went into exile. It's clear that God wants his people to return to him, and he's going to use any means he can possibly to do that. But is that why we have trials today? To bring us back to God? Maybe. But as we can see in Jesus' discourse with the disciples in John chapter 9 regarding the man born blind, it was so that the works of God might be displayed. As he went along, and this is John chapter 9 verses 1 through 3, as he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus, "but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him." That's totally consistent with James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. Cause and effect is a thing. There is certainly a cause and effect relationship in regards to sins. If we forget to change the oil in our car, it will eventually have an effect, a bad one. If we choose to harbor anger and malice toward a person, it will impact us, them, and our relationship with God. But the important component to this is not the punishment or the trial even, but the perspective of why he allows these things to happen. Even if it is a cause-effect trial, God will still use it to teach us to grow our character. Ask yourself, what is the work that God wants to display in my life? What is in need in my character? And how can we consider joy as an option when we encounter them? False assumption number 4. Trials just happen, and we have to just deal with it. This sounds totally reasonable. And if you ignore the evidence of God and his plan, it's your only choice. But it's not accurate. Even if you are not a follower of Christ presently, this is not true, because God's influence is not restricted to just believers. This boils down to our faith in God's story and plan. Testing our faith is a good thing. When our faith is tested, it becomes stronger. When you encounter a trial, you have a choice to be bitter, angry, frustrated, hurt, or not. If you only focus on the immediate pain or irritation, I bet you you'll find that the trials are negative, and God's outcome will not be achieved. 1 Peter 1:7 puts it this way. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. When water poured out of the second floor wall and cascaded into our downstairs, we were on vacation. Great. It was not fun. We had a choice when we came home. We could get all bent out of shape, look at all the negatives, but we decided that this was another instance where God was going to build character in our lives. We decided that it was not a punishment or a random chance event. We made the choice, and a peace came over us. And yet, it was still a trial. It was still a lot of work. You see, the goal of our Christian experience is a smooth transition into glory. When James 1 talks about us being perfect and complete, lacking in nothing, he doesn't mean perfection on this earth, but the eternal work God is working on our character. This transition, or that transition, a smooth transition, is where the ultimate joy will be realized. When our faith shall be sight, and it's that expectation and that perspective that gives us perfect peace. Back in the hospital room, as joy kept me company through the long hours, I rested in knowing God was producing character in me that will last for eternity. And that brought me peace. Isaiah 26:3 says, "You will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast because they trust in you." And Philippians 4:7 says, "And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Do you have peace in the midst of trials? Keep in mind that it's all part of God's story, His plan, and He's sovereign. He's good, and He's in control. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your love and your plan. I thank you that you are in control. From beginning to end, you know all of these things, and we praise you and give you glory, because there isn't any trial that we are going through now or will in the future that you didn't know about, and that you don't have a plan to build our character for the future transition into glory. God, we just praise you and thank you for all these things. In your wonderful name we pray. Amen.
Parents, you are dismissed to pick up your kids from Children's Church. Does anybody ever sing a song that just brightens your day? This next song that we're going to sing, Days of Elijah, brightens everybody's day on this stage. I'm going to go out on a limb and say that, because it's really fun to play and it's really fun to sing. So I am going to ask every one of you to stand and sing this song with joy in your hearts. Please join us.
Thank you.
that song. You are dismissed and have a wonderful week.